This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You've heard the expression, a missed opportunity. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I'm going to tell you today about one of my all-time worst or biggest missed opportunities. Back when I started the radio show in the late 90s, I went to horse expos, and I got a lot of the content for my radio show at expos, just like I do today. And one of the early ones I went to was in Kentucky. It was called Equitana. It's no longer around, but it was fantastic. There were so many people there. And there was this gentleman named Dr. Reiner Klimke, who everybody was making a big deal out of. He was like the top dressage rider living at the time. And I just didn't have the confidence at that time to pursue an interview with him, and I so wish I had somehow done that. I mean, I knew almost nothing about dressage then, and really didn't have very good interviewing chops, you know, at that early time in my career, and that all kind of fed into this lack of wanting to pursue this. I wish somehow I'd risen above that and done it, because he passed away a few years later, and I missed that opportunity. However, I later ran into one of his students, who is my guest today. His name is Ron Postleb. He was a student of Reiner Klimke's in Germany, and he's going to be here to talk today about dressage in Germany as opposed to the United States. Because, you know, we have some great dressage riders here and in Canada and lots of other countries, but Germany is still kind of considered the motherland where dressage is concerned, even though dressage is a French word, and even though it's, you know, historically it's been spread around to a lot of different countries, there's just so many great riders in Germany today. Ron is going to talk about that, kind of compare the mindset, I guess, in Germany for dressage as compared to the U.S. So he will be here for the entire hour today. Want to remind you about my website, thehorseshow.com. Go there, become a member. That is where we post all of our TV shows. Actually, they're on YouTube, but the best way to watch them, actually, and not get distracted by cute kittens and all that kind of stuff, is at our website, thehorseshow.com. And you can also listen to the radio shows there as well. All those things are available on all devices. So if you're on the go, you can take the horse show with you. In fact, we used to call it the horse show to go when we put these things in kind of a mobile format for you. Anyway, hope you'll go there and enjoy and interact with me. If you have questions or anything, topics that you would like to introduce for discussion, by all means, that is the way to do it. And I make a point of everybody who emails me or posts something on my blog or on my website, that once my reaction gets some kind of reaction from me, and sometimes it's not what they want to hear. Other times I'm able to help them quite a bit. But I think that the interaction is important. I think it's good to kind of share our thoughts. We're all on the same journey together. I know I kind of hammer on this, but I believe you can learn from me and I can learn from you. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention The Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention The Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Minnesota Horse Expo in bright and sunny, unseasonably warm and beautiful St. Paul, Minnesota, at the Minnesota State Fairgrounds. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. My guest for this segment of our program is Mr. Ron Postleb. Ron, welcome to The Horse Show.
Thank you.
You are a veteran. I say veteran, makes you sound old. You're not that old, but you're a long time. That sounds old too. How can I say this? You got a lot of experience in the sport of dressage, both in the United States and in Europe, in particular Germany, where you're from. So, I always like to kind of start at the beginning and say, tell me a little bit about your life, and then we'll get into some of these heavy topics.
All right, my horses weren't all. Always my life. I grew up in a family. There were traditionally opticians for many generations, and
you do have very nice glasses. I noticed that.
Thank you.
I like them a lot.
Yeah.
You've got taste.
It comes from the time when I was an optician. Yeah. and in Germany, it's tradition that the sons are stepping in the same footsteps as their parents. And for me, it was clear since I was a little kid that I was taking over the business. But when I was about 12 years old, I discovered horses. I grew up in the city of Berlin, and at the time I grew up, there was a wall around it.
Yes.
There wasn't a lot agricultural horses, so we had a couple of clubs where you can take lessons on school horses. And about the age of 12, we don't have any kids, you know. No, I skipped school and just to be in the barn, just to be around horses. And I got the bug and never lost it. And when I graduated from school, I went then to this optician school and just barely made my examens because my heart wasn't really in it. It was with the horses. And after being as an optician for a few years, and I talked to my mom and said, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to do horses. My dad passed away when I was 18 years old. So, and she was actually the only one who supported me. All my rest of my family was very upset. But, you know, I truly believe you only can do well in something what you really enjoy doing.
Sure.
So I decided to be a professional. And there are two different routes you can take in Germany. One is more an amateur qualification, which is more like a volunteer to the real professionals. This is something what somebody does who has a job and would like to volunteer on weekends. Mm-hmm. And I thought I'm going to take a shortcut and do a 2-week course instead of a 3-year apprenticeship. And then another year, another 2-week course instead of a 5-year additional apprenticeship. And it happened to be that I wasn't quite prepared. I went to the course, and they failed me. And I never.
And was this for, to become a berider?
No, was that, just to. It's right vart. It's called a right vart, which is
the helper,
a certified volunteer for a berider.
Okay.
And on my way home, I never forget, this was a gloomy November day. I had to drive 300 miles home, and I was very, very upset and very angry. And then this all changed in determination that I'm not doing this again. Now I'm going to do it right. And next morning I came home, I got on the phone and phoned the best school in Germany and asked for, you know, if they have an opening for an apprentice. And that was the Landesreitenfahrschule in Wülfrath, which is a government-subsidized school. And they took me in. So then I decided to do the real stuff, go to the 3 years apprenticeship, and this is what I wanted to do. I made all my exams with summa cum laude, and nobody had to tell me to read a book because I just ate them up because I was so interested doing it. And instead of 3 years, I could do my exam in 2 years. And
well, this is a good example of somebody taking a negative and turning it into a positive.
Yes.
You used that, which could have discouraged, I suppose, some people who wanted the easy path. I mean, you tried to kind of take a shortcut, but
yes.
You found out that that wasn't going to work, and you kind of channeled that into determination. You were going to really get what you wanted. So I'm convinced that sometimes life throws you little curves like that as ways to give you a kick in the rear end, to kind of get in gear and go after what you wanted. You went through a level of training that is equivalent, I believe, to our master's degree. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
What is that called in Germany?
It's called Reitlehrer FN. It's a master's degree in horsemanship. Mm-hmm. And it takes, normal way, it takes 8 years to get it.
Now, wow, 8 years.
Yes.
That's like a doctorate program in this country. Is there anything equivalent to that at all in the U.S. in terms of...
No, This is... Germany is the only country who has that kind of education for the instructor. You know, you must know that the rich history in riding in Germany has created that kind of standard. After World War II, they established government-subsidized riding academies in every province, teaching jumping, dressage, and driving, two and four in hand. And they needed a lot of good instructors. And in Germany, for example, riding is so popular, baseball and football is here.
You know, I was going to ask you, but I think you just answered that. I was going to say, why would the government be involved in promoting something like that, but I think you probably just answered that. It had become so popular that there was that much demand for it. But why does the government want to be involved in it and kind of micromanage that industry in Germany, where there's virtually no involvement by the government in it here?
Well, I think it was a necessity after World War II. We were still needed the driving horses, and the breeding in this area has a rich history up to 1732, when the Trakehner was founded. So the government was there involved. They controlled the rules and regulations for the army, for the cavalry, and it just was taken over from the civilians. And they kept the very high standard, or the goal was to keep that very high standard in Germany and continue the tradition.
When we return, why German breeds of warmbloods are not really breeds as we think of them. This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb. I'm talking to Ron Postleb. We'll be back. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. From the Minnesota Horse Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Ron Postleb. We're talking about dressage in Germany. Horses bred in Germany that are what we would consider breeds aren't as different as breeds are in the U.S. For instance, you've got the Westphalian, you mentioned Trakehner, Holsteiner, Hanoverian, Rhinelander. I mean, there's a whole bunch of...
Yes.
Explain how those designations relate to the breeding and the bloodlines of the individual horses. It has to do with where they were born, doesn't it?
Yes, yes and no. It goes back to after World War II that every province in Germany had its own breeding program. And the oldest in Germany is the Hanoverian stud farm and the Westphalian stud farm. They're all founded in the 1800s. And the oldest is in Preußen, which is Russia now, which is Trakehn, which was founded in 1732. So these provinces or states, if you want to call them, they had their own breeding program. And in the olden days, they had different functions. The Holsteiner were more heavy horses, and they were used for driving. Of course, Hannover and Westphalian, they were used for sport horses. In the past 60 years, the breeding goals became the same in each province. Some have higher standards, some has lower standards. So, for example, if you have a mare who is approved by the Hanoverian stud book, it might be also approved by the Westphalian stud book. You have a stallion who is a Hanoverian stallion, but is licensed in, let's say, Holstein and Rhineland. So if you have a stallion which is from Holstein and he breeds in Westphalian with a Hanoverian mare, it still gets a Westphalian brand. Because those two horses are meeting the standards of their breeding goals.
So what it sounds to me like is you could have 3 horses standing side by side, Westphalian, Hanoverian, and let's say a Rhinelander or whatever, and they might look identical. You could not tell by looking at them what their breed was.
No, not
because
anymore.
Because it depended on where they were born.
The best experts in the world can't say that anymore. That was maybe 30, 40 years ago you could say this is a Hanoverian, this is a typical Holsteiner, this is a Rhinelander. It's just that the standards were different.
Is it true, though, that the Westphalian is still kind of the Cadillac, if you will, or the Mercedes?
I disagree, horses. Rick. You got to see it this way.
Do they have the highest standards? Maybe that's...
No, the standards are coming pretty close. The difference is that Hannover and Westphalian have caught up earlier with the demand of refined sport horses than other provinces. For example, if you have 100 Hanoverian horses, you have maybe 80 that are excellent for dressage. You have 80 excellent Westphalian, you maybe have only 50 or 40 excellent Rhinelander, or maybe 10 excellent Bavarians, which nobody knows Bavarian horses, but there's a breed. And I
know Bavarian beer, but I didn't know Bavarian horses.
There was a couple of years ago was Sir Sinclair. He was a Bavarian horse, and he got sold at the PSI auction from Uli Kassermann for 3.2 million euros.
Whoa, I'm in the wrong business. Yeah. I need to move to Germany and get involved in breeding.
Yeah.
Compare that to American dressage horses.
Well, a lot of the American dressage horses there in the top sport are German or Dutch. There's an effort from the Americans to breed their own sport horse, but they don't have the rich history and the breeding stock. And I think a lot of people make a mistake that they're always looking for an excellent stallion and they take a mediocre mare. It is that the mare is dominant, that the mare inherits 65 to 70% and then the stallion. Of course, the stallion stems the mare, but if you have an outstanding stallion and you put a mediocre mare on, then you're not necessarily get an outstanding.
Well, there's
horse.
An old saying, at least in this country, you breed the best to the best.
Yes.
And hope for the best.
Yes.
Because it's
right.
Still a crapshoot, no matter how
absolutely,
you look at it.
Absolutely.
The other thing I'll just comment about the mare's contribution is the thing that we don't often think about is the fact that the mare, at least in semi-natural breeding operations, spends time with the baby after it's born,
mm-hmm.
and
sure.
has through her behavior an ability to imprint. Mm-hmm. Some of her temperament, for instance,
yeah.
on the baby. So it's not entirely genetic. I mean, there's some behavioral side of it, too.
I believe that, too. But, you know, in Germany, you have certain bloodlines. They are throwing excellent dressage horses, or they're talented for dressage, and others, they're excellent for jumping. And you can look this up.
One of the things it said in your bio that I wanted to ask you about was that when you do public presentations, you go out and teach. You do practical dressage clinics and you do theoretical seminars.
Yes,
how
yes.
do those differ from one another?
Well, the theory seminars are without horses and the clinics are mounted.
Okay.
And I think the
what can you teach in it without the horse being there? I mean, how do you modify it?
I think everybody who wants to be a serious dressage rider needs a proper foundation of theoretical knowledge. Otherwise, you don't know what you're looking for. So the higher you're up in the ranks, the more theory you have to study. It's like with any other art. Riding dressage is an art. And it doesn't come to you just to get on the horse. This is a very complex sport. And there's a lot of different horses, the temperament-wise, but the tools you have to learn is an understanding of the nature of the horse. You have to study the nature of the horse, and then you have to study the skills you have to apply in order to train your horse and get the best out of it. And that only can be done by theory. And we have a saying in Germany, you know, the riding instructions outside in the arena mounted should be just short reminders or short corrections. There shouldn't be lengthy explanations. This belongs into the classroom. Mm-hmm. When I teach a walk pirouette, this is a very complex movement. It takes me half an hour to really explain it down to the nitty-gritty, what you have to do, what can happen, and what in different situations you have to do. That doesn't belong into the arena. That belongs into the classroom. And then we go out, and you know what you're to do, and then I correct you and say, why not do this a little bit more, this a little less.
You know, it's interesting because you talked about studying the nature of the horse.
Mm-hmm.
And you're using the nature of the horse in riding and training him. Well, that to me is the foundation concept behind what we call natural horsemanship. Mm-hmm. So it sounds to me like you're promoting a foundation that is very compatible with what we talk about with natural horsemanship.
Yes.
Then you're taking that on and applying it to the specific riding discipline of dressage.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, you're a natural horseman, whether you know it or not. Okay.
My guest is Ron Postleb. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72 from the Minnesota Horse Expo. When we return, Ron's memories of his mentor, Dr. Reiner Klimke. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. We'll be back. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe. Thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We are back at the Minnesota Horse Expo. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. And I'm talking with dressage expert Ron Postleb. I'm going to ask you a question now. I don't want you to answer it right now. I want you to think about it. We'll come back to it a little later. This is what I call a tease.
Mm-hmm.
You, in your bio again, it said you focus on long-term success and satisfaction of each horse and rider combination. In your experience as a teacher, what is most often the impediment or the thing that gets in the way for a rider reaching that kind of a goal? Time, talent, money, whatever it may be. Don't answer it. I want you to just think about how that might play out. Let's talk a little bit about Dr. Reiner Klimke.
Mm-hmm.
Passed away a few years ago.
1999.
Very unique gentleman from a few standpoints. And I'll just leave it with that and you go forward. How did you meet him? What was your relationship with him?
I was apprenticed in one of the government riding academies in Germany. Started with age 24, and our facility was very, very large. We had 2 indoor arenas, we had a stadium, we had driving places, we had dressage warm-up, jumping warm-up, and we had one very, very big horse show in jumping and dressage every year, where the top riders in the country competing, preparing for Aachen. And so he was always there, and the first time I saw him, he has stabled his horses in our barn. He became my idol, like with a lot of other people too. I admired him for his riding skills and for his character, for his attitude to the horses, for his humane training. He came to our school and gave lessons. I wouldn't call it clinics, but he came and helped us. We could ask questions. So I asked him, can I come to your place and ride? He said, of course. And I had the horse on my own. I quite often went over there, and we started a relationship. I have never spent years with him, but I was in contact over 25 years with him. When I had a problem, I called him up, or I visit him with my horse as long as I was in Germany. In 1982, I moved to Canada, immigrated to Canada, and had the opportunity to go every year to his place, and I was one of the very few people they were allowed to ride Pascal, one of his horses.
That's quite a compliment, isn't it?
Yes, it
if somebody
is.
At that level
yes,
would
yes.
allow you to ride a horse that he put that much training on.
Yeah.
That he has to be had to be totally confident you weren't going to screw it up.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No.
A couple things that were unique about Dr. Klimke. For one thing, he wasn't a doctor of medicine or a doctor of equine science or anything. He was
a lawyer.
A lawyer.
A doctor of law. And in Germany, you can be a doctor of law or you can be a doctor of science. It's a title. And Germany is very formal, much, much more formal than in the United States. I was never on a level with Dr. Klimke that I called him Reiner. You have to be very, very good friends. So there was always a distance there, and we called him the doctor. So.
Now, he managed to win a few Olympic gold medals. Mm-hmm. A handful, a big handful.
More than a handful. He was the most highly decorated Olympic participant ever. He has 6 Olympic gold medals and 2 bronze medals.
Wow.
And he has 1 individual Olympic gold medal and 2 individual bronze medals. The other ones are teams.
And as I understand it, several of those were consecutive. I mean, it was like year after year.
Yes.
Or not year after year, but every time there was an Olympics, he would win.
Yes. He was in Tokyo. He was in Mexico. He was in Los Angeles. He was in Canada. Only missed 1 Olympic. No, actually, he didn't. 80 wasn't the Olympic because of the boycott of the Russians, right? That was in Moscow, the Olympics, and all the European countries boycotted it, so he didn't go.
So how did these other dressage riders feel about it? I mean, here's the guy that every time takes home the gold medal. That'd be kind of discouraging, wouldn't
well,
it?
Well, I mean, he was on the team.
Many, it's supposed to be good if he was on your team. The other countries probably said, oh, forget it. You know
Klimke's coming. For many years, and even today, it is if you get selected to the team, you're almost guaranteed a gold medal. And Dr. Klimke was a person who did not just had the phenomenal skills to train a horse. Not just that he could read a horse. No, he also had the skills to choose a young horse where he could say, this horse is gonna make it. There's a lot of riders, they don't have, you know, those 3 skills come together in this person, and that what makes him so unique. You have a lot of very, very good riders, but they only come up with 1 good horse, with 1 good training, and then they never show up in the Olympics again. And then there's those ones that repeatedly show up, they have at least those 3 qualities.
You mentioned how if you were chosen to the German Olympic team, you were almost guaranteed a gold medal. Was that because Germany just dominated the sport?
Well, we have so many. You see, the United States, if we have a team from 4 or 5, they are fairly good. It's great. If something happened to all those horses, we don't have an Olympic team in the States. In Germany, you have 20 riders. Maybe not that much, but you have at least 2 or 3 teams. They are equally good. And they could do very well if the top riders are not being able to make it. So the grassroots are so good that we have so many fabulous riders coming up. And it was more dominant in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, not so much anymore. I mean, the United States has caught up. I mean, we have 2 top riders from Germany, Günter Seidel and Stefan Peters. You know, they're Germans. They're trained in Germany. And they were numerous times on Olympic teams and got bronze medals. And Canada had a very good team over many, many years. So they have learned to send their people over to Germany and select horses and hook up with very good trainers for a long time, not just going and giving a clinic, staying there for years. I mean, Lisa Wilcox was there for 5 or 6 years, before she got to the Olympics.
You know, you mentioned earlier about the importance of being able to pick the horse.
Yes.
What do you think, and maybe this is something that you gleaned from being around Dr. Klimke as long as you were, what are the essential requirements of a good dressage prospect?
Well, I mean,
is it still just a guessing game, or just intuition?
There's a great deal of intuition, and this is, you know, the 6th sense or whatever. It is talent to select those horses. What you need to do when you're trying to select a dressage horse, First of all, you have to have a fairly good conformation. You have to have very good gaits, walk, trot, and canter. A very good attitude from the horse, willingness to perform, a good temperament. And that's it. So, and if you get those five points together, then you know you have a very, very good horse. For example, I tell you a story. Granat and Stücklenberger, the Switzerland people in the 60s, fabulous Olympic horse, Piaf Passage machine. And her trainer saw this horse, they bought the horse, they sold it because they couldn't think it ever would make an Olympic horse. 2 years later, they saw him, they bought him back, he changed his mind, he trained it, she won a silver medal in the Olympics. You have to have a horse which wants to perform. And sometimes you don't find that out after your horse is in training for a couple of years. And
I would suspect, though, that's kind of the raw material.
Yes, a raw diamond. And what you do is...
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so...
Diamond in the rough.
The trainer can do something to bring that out and to encourage it.
Yes.
And help it to bloom.
Yes.
Or he can suffocate it.
Destroy it. Destroy it, yes.
So it's kind of like... Plouvenel called it like a delicate flower.
Yes. Yeah.
And I think that's a good way to describe it.
My guest is Ron Postleb. We're talking about dressage. When we come back, his thoughts on what gets in most students' way. And we'll also have questions from the audience. And you know what that means. Anything can happen. You don't want to miss this.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's P-R-O-T-A-Z-I-L.com. See website for complete product safety information. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Small thing for you, big deal for us. We do appreciate your help. My guest is Ron Postleb. We're talking about dressage and his mentor, Dr. Reiner Klimke. How would you like to see Dr. Klimke remembered?
As an outstanding horseman, he was an advocate of humane training from the first moment he started riding. He was an event rider and changed to dressage. He was opposed to all force to the horse. That's how he should and is remembered. He's an outstanding horseman who loved his horses and who was able to get the best out of them.
What was the most important thing you learned from him?
Humane training, and always question yourself when you try to teach a horse something and the horse is not doing it. Ask yourself, what did I do wrong? Did I ask the question wrong, or was it the wrong question?
I'm laughing because this is you're like a textbook natural horseman, because I mean, it's like, it's never the horse's fault.
No, it's not.
It's not. No. That's just the way it is. I ask you to be thinking about a question. You focus in your training and teaching on long-term success and satisfaction of each horse and rider combination. I said, what usually gets in the way with people? Did you think of something?
I think impatient from the rider, doubtfulness. I have seen this so many times that people are doubting themselves that they can do it. And also another reason is that people put their goals too high and they are frustrated that they can get it.
That's interesting. Do you recommend that they lower their expectations?
Absolutely.
Really?
Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I mean, it's if you have a goal, you go to the goal, but set goals in between. You know,
yes.
Don't buy a Shire horse or a Clydesdale and say, I want to go to the Olympics. And the first time you ride a training level test and you only get 40%, you quit riding.
Yeah.
So you have to see it realistically. And a lot of people missing a little common sense, a little bit realistic, thinking about what their goals are.
Realistic as opposed to being overly optimistic,
yes.
It sounds like. Very good. Well, an important part of what we do is get your input. So you've heard some of the thoughts that my guest Ron Postleb has expressed up here. Some of the things I was curious about. I'm curious to see what you're interested in. So does anybody here have a question they would like to pose to kind of get us started? Back in the back, thank you so much for breaking the ice. What always happens, there's one brave soul who starts it out, and then the floodgates open, everybody wants to talk. Okay, yes ma'am.
I was gonna ask you about German riding ponies, because I ride dressage, it has started, but I don't want to ride a big horse, but I'm looking for an upper level later, and so I was looking at German riding ponies because of my size.
German riding ponies are very, very popular in Germany, and it is very, very difficult to get them for a reasonable price. If you buy a German riding pony, which is untrained, you get them for a reasonable price. If you look for a pony which competes in FEI or even Grand Prix, you're looking up about $100,000. Pony riding or young riders with ponies is very, very, very popular. And we have probably the highest standard in the world in pony riding.
So, do you define pony the same way we do over here at 14 hands and below?
I think so. I'm not quite sure, but I do the requirements are the same in Germany and here, yes.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
What kind of handling would you do or not do? Like, what kind of work would you want to do with a young horse that's just 2 years old? You know, do you want to be doing much with them, lunging or any kind of work with them? Or do you just leave them to grow up still?
No, we usually leave our horses alone until they're 3 years old. The only thing what I would recommend is that I don't know where the horse is, but you know, that you start handling, bringing him in, halter, and pick up the feet and things like that, and grooming. But we leave them alone until they're turning three, and then we're going to put them in the program and breaking them, riding them maybe three times a week, four times a week. Very light, and then according to the talent of the horse and according to the progress you do, you increase your training or you decrease your training.
Good question. We had another question right over here. Yes, ma'am.
This might be too technical, but could you talk a little bit about different types of half halts?
I need another half hour about that. There are many different half halts. There is a half halt to regulate the tempo. There's a half halt to position your horse, there's a half halt to bend your horse, there's a half halt to turn your horse, there's a half halt to collect your horse. So they're all very similar. If you start breaking a horse, you start with a very, very simple things. Move forward, come back. The horse has to learn, put my legs on, you move forward. I half halt with both reins, he has to slow down. He doesn't even have to be on the bit. And then we go from there. Then we teach him how to bend his neck on a half halt. Then we teach him to go onto the bit. Then get refined until we come and teach him from trot to piaf, from trot to passage. Those half halts are very similar, but there is a big difference.
You tied that up in a real nice little package there. Yes, ma'am. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were just waving at me. You're scratching your head. Okay. Anybody else have a question or a comment here? Do you believe, Ron, that every horse and every rider can benefit from studying dressage?
I'm not quite sure to answer the question with yes. If I see the gated horses, I'm probably not. This is so different, and I really don't know very much about it. I think every hobby rider, the basic training of a horse, how to go forward, how to stop, how to go trot, how to go canter, how to turn. That's what you learn in the basic training in dressage. And we don't even talking about fancy stuff like half passes, flying changes or something like that. But the basic training, yes, I do believe that a lot of riders, they ride all kinds of horses, can absolutely benefit of this, yes.
Are there any essential texts that you recommend to people?
Yes, I would recommend the principles of riding from the German Equestrian Federation. This is guidelines they are put out since 1945, and dating back until 1932, was called the Heeresdienstvorschrift, was started from the military, and then worked over many, 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 many times, year after year. Looked over and edited and things like that. So they are very clear, very short, no big stories around it, very simple explained. And then, you know, if you understand that, then you can go to other books.
So that is by the German
Equestrian Federation.
German Equestrian Federation, and the yes. title of it again is what?
Principles of Riding.
That's pretty easy to remember,
yes.
Principles of Riding.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because dressage, the word itself is a French word.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, early days, Hody Cole and all of that, and Airs Above the Ground and a lot of that stuff, and Laguerre, Plouvenel, I mentioned, those were Frenchmen.
Yes.
Is there still kind of a sense of competition today between France and Germany?
No, I don't think so. We don't use the word dressage in German. We use Dressur, which is translated maybe taming.
Taming.
Yes. So it sounds very similar, dressure and dressage.
You know, it's curious you said that, because one of the great dressage masters today is Charles de Comfy.
Yes.
And I had a conversation once with him when we were talking about just what the word dressage meant, and of course the traditional translation of that is training.
Training, yes.
And he said, I like to also think of it as taming.
Yes.
That's it, because that was a reminder. He said, it always reminds me that what we've got here is essentially a wild animal.
That's true. Yeah.
So that's a pretty good way to do it. Does anybody have any final comments or questions before we do our drawing? Well, let me tell you just a little bit about what we're drawing for. My sponsor for my expo appearances this year is called Daily 72, and that is a brand new product. It's kind of space age technology. They get it they get it out of mining minerals out of the ground, and they turn it into a liquid ionic form that you can just spray or just squirt on the top of your horse's feed one time a day in the morning. Pellets, hay, whatever it is you feed your horse, it doesn't matter. And they love the taste of it, by the way. And it gives your horse all 72 of the essential minerals that they need every single day. How is this different from like a trace mineral block or something like that? Well, horses don't really go to the block unless they feel the need for salt, because that's the primary element in there. They lick it when they feel the need for salt. That's how they get the minerals. Also, those this is ionic, so it means it goes in right at the cell level. It's instantly absorbed, and you definitely see a change in your horse. There's both maintenance formula and performance formula of this product. Daily72.com is the website. What we're going to do is give away a gallon of this, and you won't have to lug it around. Don't worry. We're going to mail it to you. My guest, Ron Postleb, you're going to be the drawer. So dig deep and pick our winner. All right. Jeff Dauber. Jeff, are you here? Is that you? Give him a hand. Come on up, Jeff. Well, you don't need to come up. Do you want maintenance or performance? That's your choice. Maintenance, okay. We will send this to you. You'll probably forget all about it, and then one day you'll get a box in the mail and you'll say, oh, I remember that. All right. Ron, do you have a website or anything that you can refer people to? What is it?
Yeah, yes, I do. My website is crowndressage.com.
Crown Dressage.
Yes, just like the crown from the king, and then dressage.com.
And that
yes.
happens to be the name of your stable, isn't it? Crown Dressage International?
Yes, that's the all name right. of my stable too, yes.
My guest has been Ron Postleb. Ron, thank you for being here. Thank you all for coming today.
Thanks for having me. Pleasure.
Isn't that kind of an interesting sound, that kind of resonant clapping? This was actually recorded. There's this building that is there on the grounds of the Minnesota State Fair in St. Paul, Minnesota, where the Minnesota Horse Expo is every single year. And where they always put me was this building, and they called it the DNR building for Department of Natural Resources. And it was a cavernous big thing that had kind of an open space in it. They could put chairs and we could have a sound system and all of that, and do these presentations that were so much part of the expo there. Not only me, but all the other presentations like that were put there. Anyway, it was kind of a big, musty-smelling place. I think they opened it after having it closed up all winter long, like the day before the expo. So half the time I'd come in there and it would be dark, and there'd be like these stuffed bears and all this kind of stuff, and wandering around there in the dark trying to find a light switch sometimes. I never quite knew what I was going to run into, but fond memories nonetheless. Some of the greatest interviews that I've had the good fortune to do on the horse show happened in that very building, including this one with Ron Postleb. So I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you enjoyed hearing about the great Reiner Klimke and my great lost opportunity, missed opportunity. Ron's website, by the way, is crowndressage.com, just like it sounds, and you can certainly learn more about what he's up to by visiting his website. Don't forget my website, thehorseshow.com. You can go there, become a member, have access to all of our media there, our TV and radio shows, and my blogs. And I invite you to take part in the discussion through my blog articles. You can introduce a new topic. If there's something you'd like for me to cover, I respond to everybody who reaches out to me. I promise you that. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.